Hello, friends. This is Hank. Welcome to a different sort of forum. Call it Raleigh Tavern, the Apollo Room, after the tavern in Williamsburg, Virginia, where early Americans would meet and gather. And the entire purpose of this live stream is simply to offer a forum for what's generally considered to be Enlightenment ideas or philosophy, much in the spirit of Café Procope. I believe that's how it's said. It's French. And that would be where Voltaire and Diderot and Jefferson and Franklin and Rousseau and Montesquieu all hung out in Paris during the Enlightenment. So, for the most part, what's going to happen is I'm going to just go about my work. And if you happen to join the live stream, then just post something in the chat, because I don't have any other windows up that will show me how many are in the chat or participating in the chat. For the most part, I do not intend to entertain. All the videos from this forum will be set to private, unless there's a specific clip or something that's requested, or a point of interest, or a point that could be explored, in which case I'll simply cut the recording and do a repost. And for the most part, I just leave it up so that you will join me. There will always be an opportunity for an open forum. And as for the moment, I'm going to make a little tofu, agidashi tofu. And if there's a visitor, then so be it. If there's not, that's fine too. I'd be doing the same thing anyway. So, enjoy. And if you pop in and say hello, well, I suppose we can get a discussion going. It's Hank, your pajama scholar, host at the Raleigh Tavern. All right, I'll teach you the secret of a good agidashi tofu. Make it real easy. First, you're gonna need extra firm tofu. You're gonna need green onion, and you're gonna need radish and ginger root. Now, the important thing about the radish is when you get it home from the store, you wanna clean it. You wanna remove all those leaves and things from it. You even want to trim the tops of them. Make sure that they'll keep a lot better. If you leave any of that junk on there, if you leave any of that or like leafy material and stick it in the refrigerator, those radishes will rot. They won't keep. You want to kind of keep it on the top shelf or wherever it's kind of cool. For your green onion, I like to take it home and wash it. And then I wrap it in a wet paper towel. And then I stick that wet paper towel inside of a like a brown plastic bag, a shopping bag, and just kind of lightly wrap it. And then stick that back inside of the produce bag that it comes in and stick it in the refrigerator and it'll preserve very nicely. But you don't want your green onion to freeze. As for the ginger root, you can just get one of those big ones. Cut it off as you need it. The extra firm tofu, you need to take one block of it and stand it up on its side. Cut it in half. And you should be able to do three cuts once you've put it back on the set the two pieces on the broad side where they're still stacked. Cut it into three sections, and then you're going to want to turn. And make four cuts, and that will give you 24 pieces. So you can cook them in two batches of 12. You're going to need cornstarch. So, right at the moment, I have my cut tofu. Takes about 8 minutes. You want to wrap that in a paper towel. Because when it comes out of the refrigerator, it's going to have a lot of moisture still in it. If you don't want to muck up your cornstarch too much, and you want to have the appropriate amount of cornstarch on the tofu, you kind of want to get rid of some of that excess moisture. And just by virtue of letting it sit in those paper towels for about 8 minutes, you're going to end up with something that's going to be ready to dip and fry. The first thing that I did was prepare the sauce. And this is all a vegetarian meal. It's vegan if you get the dashi without the fish in it, the dashi powder without the fish in it, which is a little bit more difficult to come by, but you can still order it. So for the sauce, I take 1/3 a cup of water, and then I take 2 tablespoons, 2.5 tablespoons of soy sauce, 1.5 tablespoons of mirin, and just a shade over 1/4 of a teaspoon of dashi powder. Now, when I get the dashi powder that comes in sort of like this bead in these beads, so I take my mortar and pestle and grind those beads until it's a very fine powder. Put that powder into a separate glass jar, and that way, when I'm ready to prepare the meal, it's already ground up, and that way, it will go into the sauce. It'll dissolve into the sauce a little bit more evenly. Take a fork, I whip the sauce, and while I wait for the tofu to dry, I basically let that sauce breathe a little bit. Now, the strange thing about an agidashi tofu sauce is that if one of these components is off by, like, even a little bit, it's going to change the dynamic. Like, I would think that soy sauce, mirin, water, and dashi powder would taste terrible. Like, it'd be like drinking pure soy sauce, is what I thought. But when you marry these elements, and even a shade over or shade under of any one of these elements is going to produce a whole new type of flavor. So it's about finding balance. And the chemistry of it, I do not know, but it produces an outstanding sauce. So as soon as that tofu gets dry enough, I'll take my cornstarch. And I usually take 3 scoops of cornstarch and put it in a separate bowl away from my dry cornstarch. Cornstarch is so expensive, I don't like anything to go to waste. So I just, I guess, roll the tofu in the cornstarch, and I throw it into a plate, kind of toss it gently into the plate, and that kind of shakes off the excess cornstarch. Now, while I'm putting the cornstarch on the tofu, it's time to start preheating the oil. Now, I use a deep fryer. I've got one of those little home deep fryers, and you can use any kind of oil. I use canola oil. Sometimes you can use vegetable oil. It doesn't really matter all that much, as long as the oil is clean. If you're not frying meat in your fryer, in your deep fryer, if you're just frying the same thing like tofu, you can actually get quite a few uses out of your out of the same oil, as long as you cover the oil when you're done. And as long as you kind of course, shake off that excess so it doesn't go down into the oil. And then I'll load 12 pieces into the basket after preheating it at about a shade under 350 degrees. And I'll cut my sauce just a little bit over medium heat before I drop the tofu. Because I don't want, because there's only going to be a little bit of liquid in the pan. It's not very much that's going to be in the pan. So you can, it'll come to a boil very quickly. And then it'll start evaporating some of that. It's going to actually condense the flavor, so you don't want to evaporate it. You don't want to bring it to like a quick boil or anything. You want to kind of heat it up, and you'll get a little bit of simmering action in there. Get a little simmering action in there, it's fine. Just cut it back down a little bit and put a lid over the sauce. As for the frying, I leave it in the fryer for, this is something you kind of get a feel for, but for a couple of minutes in the bottom. And that way what it does is it gives the opportunity for that tofu to kind of firm up inside of the oil as it cooks and really bind that cornstarch to the tofu. You don't want to let it sit in there too long or the tofu becomes hard. You want to set that first, when it first goes in, you want it to harden up so that way when you take it out and you shake it so it doesn't stick to the bottom of the basket. That's why you want to make sure that that tofu is kind of firmed up before you make that first shake. Then we'll drop it back in so that, you know, hoping that the tofu hasn't stuck to the bottom. It takes a little practice, but you should be able to handle it. And then just let it firm up. By that time, the sauce is done. Pull out the tofu. Now, you don't want to drain the tofu. You actually want the oils on it. So you'll drop 6 pieces. This is for 2 servings. I'll drop 6 pieces in one bowl, 6 pieces in another. And then I'll take my chopped green onion. And I use about a tablespoon of green onion on each, of chopped green onion on each bowl. I grate ginger root, and that's kind of to your own taste, but if you use a little, it'll kind of spice it up a little bit. If you use a lot, it'll really kind of bring that spice up in the whole of the dish. Like, during the winter seasons or cold and flu seasons, I always think it's a good idea to add a little bit more ginger root to things, just like I would add more garlic to things for their, I suppose, medicinal properties, immune-boosting properties, or whatever. I mean, I've found that if I'm eating a lot of ginger root or garlic, I'm not as prone to get sick. In fact, with a steady diet and stuff like that, I haven't gotten sick in years. So, once the tofu and the green onion and the ginger root is in the bowl, you're going to want to pour the sauce into each bowl in equal proportion. Now, this is going to it's going to take all the sauce that you have in the pan. That's why I make it in 2 separate batches. And lastly, you'll want to put your grated radish, just throw it right on top. And that's partially for color, partially for a garnish. It also has a tendency to kind of clean the the blades on your cowbell, on your grater, because the radish has got so much kind of moisture in it already, and it'll be ready for that next batch that you make when you go to grate your next piece of ginger root. And you just throw that on top, and that red color from the radish, like I say, pleases the eye, but also it soaks up the sauce, it goes on top of the tofu, adds a little bit. It's just more in the meal, makes it a little bit more robust. And that's pretty much it. So I'm going to get in there and fry it up, come right back and eat. There we are. Agidashi tofu. Now this entire playlist here is a little experimental, of course. And I'll only do it again, really, if it's something that people find beneficial. I'm doing most of my work right now in Course in Miracles. A little bit of the secret ashram. But for the most part, I'm exploring the aspects of God. And this, when I'm finally done, I'll do an AGR about it. I had thought about doing some work on State of Affairs, which I still may do. It's, you know, of course, political. I'll pull a little something here, considering that I've gone kind of crazy with what I had promoted early. As far as an idea, kind of actually wrote my outline online. Now this is, let me do a proper screen share here. Now this is, he's a Death Star community. And he was going over, you know, a couple of different points, what he thought China was going to be like in their relationship with Russia. And for the most part, I disagree. So you can watch his piece. I'll probably flesh a little bit of this out in a format that makes more sense. A lot of times when I'm commenting online or even participating in live chat, there's no time to edit. I mean, if you're so inspired, then it's just time to write out some draft and really explore the permutations of it later. because, you know, it might not be a good idea or a complete idea or a fully historically accurate idea. But in this particular case, let's see. I've decided, at least for an outline, to go with something about, you know, the current American, we call it, administration. Because we're not so certain that Biden legitimately won the election. Because we've seen a lot of evidence to the contrary. But whether he did or he did not, in my opinion, is of no consequence. Well, not necessarily of no consequence, but given the array of options that we have, have elected to just go ahead and accept, or rather, tolerate this current administration. I mean, because let's be honest, at this point, we could never be terribly certain that any of our election results or any of our elections are valid, and this could have been going on for a very long time. So, just by virtue of the fact that we're all aware of it now, changes the dynamic, the political dynamic. So basically, in the outline, you know, Dr. Farrell is worried about the geopolitical fallout. Well, I went ahead and create a little outline about what I will potentially address. First point being why Americans have chosen, and I use the word chosen, not elected, to tolerate the current administration. Well, it's because I believe that there are defenses, counters, and internal mechanisms of the Republic that are arrayed to disrupt any or a whole lot of destructive policies that would be implemented by an untrustworthy executive branch. I mean, this has been something that's going on, been going on in American politic for a very long time. We get executive overreach, and we get a Congress that abdicates its responsibility. And so now that most Americans are aware of the dangers of DC and the corruption that is part of the culture of the political class, states, individual legislators, private citizens, business interests, legal scholars, judges now have the political support of the citizenry to support their decisions, which will provide benefit to things that are local. And like I say, block executive overreach. You know, I've heard many people, well, not many, well, more than one, a few people, some Americans, one Canadian specifically, says, "Oh, you have no more constitution," or "This is a banana republic," or, you know, "There is no rule of law." Well, let me be clear. The Republic exists within your heart and within your mind. Our Constitution, while they may scribble over it, while they may not obey it, they might not even appreciate the spirit of the law, they may hide behind it without appreciating the essence of what it is. In fact, it appears that most people in power, especially those that serve the oligarchs, have little regard for the citizenry around the world. So for somebody to tell me that the Constitution is null and void, or that the Republic no longer exists, or our Constitution is only a scrap of paper, you can kiss the fattest part of my ass, because it exists. You will have to conquer us, and that's not going to happen. So we'll tolerate, for the sake of the Republic, but that doesn't necessarily mean that we will obey the dictates of the illegal dictates of what could be considered an illegitimate political system. Doesn't mean that our political system is dead. It doesn't mean the Constitution is dead. It just means that we have an excess of those who are ethically retarded. You know, you could have a lot of money, you could be a very, very smart person, you could be a skilled orator, you could be the best at many things, but if you do not have a strong moral compass, you know, I would take a 5-year-old over a CEO who would be considered, in my opinion, morally retarded or ethically challenged, ethically retarded. I mean, one thing about people, you don't have to be smart. You don't have to be rich. You don't have to be strong to be a good and moral person. So, now, went on, I think, in this outline, which policies will be unopposed as they are of benefit and no challenge to progress or time. So, in my opinion, as it's always been, there has been no executive leadership in America that I have ever appreciated. I've seen them all for the entirety of my life make promises that were not fulfilled and lie through their teeth and consistently overreach their authority and consistently attempt to break the social contract that we call the supreme law of the land, the Constitution of the United States of America. So whether it be George Bush Jr. stealing the election from Gore in Florida, or Trump that was politically running against Caligula or Hillary Clinton, the most hated woman in the entire world, or Trump versus Biden. They are opposing groups. They are opposing factions with different ideas about which of their team will win and how they will manipulate global events for the benefit of their team. But seldom have I ever seen honesty, integrity, and putting the American people first. So, how does that make any difference in my life? To me, even as questionable as the election is, now that people are watching and paying attention, it would appear that old business is the same as this new business. So I concentrate on the preservation of the continuity of the Republic, so that which was hollow will return to virtue. Because a problem can never be solved unless it is first recognized. And then when it is recognized, it can be addressed. And we can address, I mean, the will of the American people is strong. Once we recognize these problems, we can address them in an orderly fashion. And I would say the cat is out of the bag, and most Americans no longer believe the lies that are pumped out by these, if you can call them, human creatures. The morally retarded, the worst of us, what do they call it, a cacistocracy? The worst. And then a clear path to a stable future. And again, I believe in the continuity of the Union. You know, there's been a lot of people that talk about succession or secession. And I'm of the opinion that, like that old nursery rhyme, Humpty Dumpty sat on a wall, Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. All the king's horses and all the king's men could not put Humpty together again. So I'll oppose the dissolution of the Union. It's much easier to check the overreach of DC. I mean, if you really think about it, it's a territory, not even a territory, it's a district, it's not even a state, smaller than Rhode Island, that has no industry that I'm aware of, aside from graft. It doesn't have a great population. I mean, really, it's... I mean, Rhode Island, quite frankly, is more powerful than D.C., if you look at it from a strategic or logistical standpoint. It's only through the ability for a few select individuals to command those that will hear them. Like, for example, Biden's goes in and signs that executive order that everybody on federal property must wear a mask, while not moments afterward he and his family are out partying without masks on federal property. I mean, it's for we and not for thee. And the hypocrisy has reached a level of absurd proportions. Everyone recognizes this. Now, in the clear path to a stable future, examine organizing financial and industrial interest to clearly communicate the intent of the direction of the Republic, and patiently moving toward what I say is our objective in the outline, but what I mean is the objectives of a stable republic. It's not on what we can find to disagree about. It's the things that we can find that we can all agree on that will move us toward a period of progress. And I just mentioned somewhat sarcastically, governments around the world are run on a schedule with a longer term than tween with TikTok. So in this period of instability, I advocate and appreciate patience. That's what you do in a period of instability. You prepare for, if you were doing any disaster preparation in Florida, we get hurricanes. We expect to have natural disasters. And so what we do is we provision and prepare ahead of time, or we get the hell out of Dodge, depending on the projected strength of the storm. But we have our plans, and we execute our plans. But when the storm is here, you don't deviate from that plan. It's not time to move. You just hunker down and ride it out with what you have where you are, patiently, until the storm blows over. And it does. Like I say, in time, this too shall pass. So, in my heart, in my mind, I don't give up. I was actually drinking quite a bit. And when I get really deep into the cups, I can get incendiary, abrasive, and aggressive. Generally speaking, when I first start off, I get a little bit more verbose, get a little bit more relaxed, and I explore the edges of what might be acceptable. And then I'm going to start pushing the boundaries. And then I'm going to finally get to the point where I'm so drunk it's almost intelligible writing. And I'll be ranting about the Volstead Act or just typing racial epithets into the chat boxes. Just, I don't know. Then frustration. I don't even know if it's that or just be a dick. Be a dick, quite frankly. Just to piss people off. Be incendiary for no reason other than being, just to be an asshole. Really? So you can kind of, I don't know if you read, if you ever come across one of the live streams or something I can participate in, generally you'll be able to infer my level of drunkenness by how either intense or insincere my language gets. So, we were discussing the geopolitical benefits because Dr. Farrell believes there would be a lot of geopolitical blowback. And I say, if we just hang tight, chill, be patient, utilize the mechanisms, the legal structures that are available to us in a republic, checks and balances, we begin to work on the initiatives that will benefit the citizenry. Lay the groundwork so that when it is time, well, we're ready to unroll. We're ready to roll with those plans. And so, while Dr. Farrell believes that other governments may look at us like we're a banana republic, I say, no, just appreciate our American commitment to peace because we're not so ready, to jump out and start shooting at each other. We're not going to devolve into civil war. We're not going to we're much more creative. We have other ways of solving our problems than shooting at each other. throwing it all the way, letting it go tits up. No. No. We will be committed to peace. We will honor our allies without rash action. And, like I say, demonstrate that we're capable of creative solutions that don't involve the application of high explosives. And as for agreements, his particular concern was as to whether or not foreign governments would honor agreements made by this administration, which has already proven that it can't honor its agreements because day one, that mask mandate is not obeyed by the very person and family that wrote it. So no, I don't suspect that you could lend a lot of those agreements don't have very much credibility. But if you don't believe in the strength of the agreement with the executive branch, you have to kind of look into the heart of, or the soul of Americans. Like, for example, that START treaty, that nuclear arms ban between the United States and Russia, to bring back that agreement, I think is a very, very positive thing. And I do believe that Americans have absolutely no issue with honoring that at all. So, but when it comes to, like, hearing bullshit regarding those mask mandates or them building internment camps or they want to do COVID passports or any other such fucking nonsensical thing, fuck them. I won't hear it. An executive order, number one, is not a law. I don't even think it applies to the citizens. Like, I believe it can only apply to those employed by the federal government. Or the ones that are directly under the command of the executive branch. Like, for something to be a law, it must go through Congress for that to be part of the citizenry. I don't follow the dictates of the president. I don't answer to executive orders. I'm no legal scholar, but to my understanding, I mean, when I was a kid, an executive order was basically almost unheard of. And we definitely didn't have impeachments, sometimes two of them or more, for every president that comes in as a political tool. When I was a kid, there were no fences around D.C. Like, I heard Pelosi and a few other people in Congress, and clearly Biden, and have called for more security. They need more security, more security. I'm going, well, you got 30 fucking thousand National Guard troops in D.C., and you still don't feel secure. You know, have you ever considered quitting and going the fuck home? Because if you're that hated that you believe that you need security from the American people, that means we don't like you. We don't believe you represent us. Go the fuck home. It's that simple. You don't need more security. You need to go the fuck home. That's pretty clear. If you're that hated. That seems to be common sense. I mean, but it's like, in the Senate at least, it's almost become like a Senate seat is now a lifetime appointment. I mean, I seriously have questions about Nancy Pelosi's competency. And all the other legacy senators. It's not supposed to be a lifetime appointment. In the founding of the Republic, you're not supposed to even get paid. It's supposed to cost you. You might have a little stipend, but that's it. And then you do your service for the benefit of America, for the country, and then you go the fuck home and go back to work. You don't have these political appointments for the entirety of your life. You serve, you go home. And then having been a senator or having had some experience within the office, I'm sure that you would have more than enough political clout to reach back into or exert some political influence over the affairs where you're home. But how, in my mind, how can any member of Congress, especially those of the Senate, truly represent the interests of the American people if they never stay the fuck home or bring someone new from where they are from? It's clear to see why these disconnects exist, because I mean, DC is an echo chamber of lobbyists, sycophants, legacy politicians, think tanks, international organizations, NGOs. I mean, quite frankly, DC is a cesspool. I mean, we've all know that. That's nothing new. But yeah, we should have term limits anyway. And I suppose I go on to say, you know, an agreement with merit must stand. And I believe that the Biden administration has a very, very long journey to establish any credibility whatsoever. I mean, it's like the Obama administration all over again. And have you seen John Kerry? I mean, the guy's looking pretty friggin' rough. Looking pretty sickly. I mean, it's got to be the most enfeebled administration that I think we've ever seen. Now, at this particular point in history, I would like to at least see an idea of clear leadership and some sort of response. Some sort of direction, some sort of leadership offered to the American people to inspire some confidence. But frankly, I don't think that that's what the plan is, which is why, again, many Americans and many other people around the world in their own countries have become very skeptical of the governments. Because the governments do not appear to represent the issues or the interests of the people. Now, I'm not saying this is in all cases, but it would certainly appear to be the case in many instances. So, we'll just see how it goes. Take it a day at a time. I'm not that kind of guy that panics. It'll be considered. You know, when you're uncertain about a situation, if you're not clear, in my opinion, there's only two ways to handle it. One is to pause and reflect and be patient, or just continue with the plan that you have in place. Now, this has been a different format. I may put some timestamps and something in it. Maybe we'll get to this last conversation, because that's this last piece has been more in the vein of an AGR. I just wanted to see how, like, a Raleigh Tavern Apollo Room format would be if I had just kind of left the live stream open for people to come in, give my audience a greater opportunity to interact, put some things on the table to explore, to entertain if you're bored. And I suppose, since I need to actually get on and take care of some business, I'll leave it at that. It's been Hank, your pajama scholar. Catch you on the flip side.